Sir Mehmood Saab, and by the way, Mehmood Mandviwalla Saab is a prominent lawyer, has been practicing under the Mandviwalla and Zafar brand name, and he has been associated for a very long time with the bar, and he is the one who also organizes the legal SAARCLAW conference, and he does that every year in Pakistan, and he's, so what a pleasure, sir Mehmood Saab, to have you here, sir. So my question to you would be that could you address the adequacy of the legislative framework on the subject of discussion, one. Two, I would like you to talk about if possible on the financial crime typologies, and which specific areas would you require rejuvenated attention, and then how do you think is the positioning of our laws with respect to enforceability as well as creating the right accountability culture. So you can go one by one, but I can repeat it if you
want. No, that's fine.
Okay.
Thank you, Irfan sir. Assalamu alaikum, everyone. So I'll just make four points as an overall answer to your question, and then we can, as the session goes along. The first point I have picked up from the earlier discussions and the presentations that took place, and that is really applying all that I have sort of learned since morning till now to our own legal profession. There are approximately 160,000 lawyers practicing in Pakistan who are registered practitioners, whether they are practicing or not, but they are registered with the provincial bar councils. About 100,000 of them are in Punjab, 35,000 in Sindh, and the rest are elsewhere. So I think one of the things that, in reference to this topic, that is lacking, what Irfan Saab, you mentioned in your speech as well, and so did Salim Raza Saab, is motivation. I think in this subject, our motivation is completely fractured. So I think we need to bring that for the legal community first. Second, you mentioned about international exposure. And you mentioned how indebted you are to the State Bank for having given you that opportunity. I think that is also where we all lack, is international exposure. Because this, maybe to the panel over here, is not that sophisticated law, because we are used to it. But to the majority of the practitioners, this would be too sophisticated, because they don't have the exposure. And the third is knowledge. So there is no concept of continuing legal education in Pakistan. It's what I learn on the job. That's my continuing legal education. And these are now specialist areas that are coming in. So as an opening remarks, I would say this. In terms of the other three points that I want to make, and I'll briefly make each one of them, so there is, you know, hopefully there'll be some debate on each one of them. In terms of new laws, I would propose maybe that we look at three different areas of laws. It's always easy to say whenever India makes the law, we blindly follow, or it's another way of putting it is when they make the mistake, we also blindly follow. So, sir, there they are trying to legalize hawala. And they don't see hawala or all kinds of hawalas as being illegal. And that's why for them, movement of currency, which is all about our laws, it's all about movement of currency, of money, they have talked about receipt of money, not just movement through banking system. And they are equating the entire hawala concept with branchless banking. And they are saying that hawala is akin to what branchless banking would be, the speed, the availability, the access, except that it's not regulated. So they are trying to frame laws so that the payment systems that you have through branchless banking network, at least a portion of the hawala is brought into the banking sector, and you make the make it so attractive rather than choking it with state controls that it becomes easier. The second area of change would be with the Electronic Cyber Crime Act. So before I came here, when I was invited, I checked up with the FIA Cyber Crimes Unit as to the percentage of how many financial crimes are reported there, their total. That's only 14%. Why? Because the rest of them all relate to social media, online harassment, stalking, online identity, theft, defamation, Facebook, so on and so forth. So this means that this law has become too general, and it's not really catering to financial crimes, because it's just, it's got probably got lost into that law, and maybe we need specialized or dedicated laws there. The third area, sir, is real estate. And you, some of you have mentioned that proceeds of crime go into real estate. And I think there, Uzam would know much more, that when a property is purchased, the burden that is cast on the lawyer in most countries is very high. And all the AML requirements are satisfied by the lawyer before the property is purchased. Here it's the other way around. We are facilitating an unofficial payment that is being made for purchase of property, because there is nothing that compels us to do the KYC which you compel the banks to do, or in any manner to check the source of funds or to report the source of fund. So automatically, until this area is regulated some form or the other, it will continue to have the legal endorsement of transactions. And finally, I think the comment I would make generally on the laws is, any kind of crime or any kind of, you know, whichever way you look at crime, it will be clouded with secrecy. And that is what we really have to make sure, that veil of secrecy is lifted, which all of you are talking about. Thank you, sir.